It's the month of May, and although I've hit a stride making sports car racing content on this channel, it'd be remiss of me to not make a video about IndyCar and the Indianapolis 500. Those who have followed the NTT IndyCar series in the last decade would know that there are two manufacturers fighting for the championship. But in 2012, there was a third manufacturer racing against Honda and Chevrolet. I don't want to say fighting for a championship because, well, you'll see. This is the story of the Lotus IndyCar program. If you want to talk about the 2012 Lotus IndyCar program, you'll first need to talk about the 2012 IndyCar regulations as a whole. For the first time in the 2000s, the regulations meant that V8s would no longer be powering the cars. Instead, they were replaced by 2.2-liter turbocharged V6s. It was the first season that utilized turbochargers since the 1996 IRL season and 2007 Champ Car season, respectively. In addition to the new engines, the now-aged Dallara IR05 chassis was replaced by the Dallara DW12. The initial plan of the DW12 called for a spec chassis with manufacturer-specific bodywork, but the manufacturer aero kits didn't make an appearance until 2015, before being scrapped at the end of the 2017 season. The Lotus IndyCar program promised an engine and aerodynamic bodywork to challenge Chevrolet and Honda. The Lotus Aero kit never saw the light of day because of IndyCar's decision to delay its introduction to the 2015 season. So let's talk about the engine. The 2012 regulations called for all manufacturers to run 2.2-liter turbocharged V6 engines. Chevrolet had committed to twin turbochargers, and Honda ran a single turbo for the 2012 and 2013 seasons. At the 2010 Los Angeles Auto Show in mid-November 2010, Lotus officially announced their twin-turbo engine, which would be built under an alliance between John Judd and Jack Brabham. Judd has a known track record in racing, having supplied engines in Formula One and kart in the 1980s and 90s. They were also a prominent engine manufacturer for a variety of LMP2 teams until the new LMP2 regulations were introduced in 2017. Lotus's IndyCar engine then seemed to be in experienced hands, but that's about where the good news ended. In reality, this engine was crippled by the two things that made the subject of my last video a failure: time and money. On the topic of time, Lotus weren't able to achieve any track testing for months after Honda and Chevrolet had begun theirs, and money became an issue when the project's funding was cut for 2 months during a change in the company's corporate ownership. By the time the engine was locked in for homologation in January of 2012, Lotus were already miles behind the competition. At the season opener in St. Petersburg, five drivers representing four teams ran Lotus engines. Alex Tagliani running for Brian Herta Autosport, Oriol Servia running for Dreyer and Reinbold, Simona Di Silvestro for HVM Racing, and Sebastian Bourdais and Catherine Legg both running for Dragon Racing. In qualifying, the Lotuses weren't awful, but they were far from spectacular, with Alex Tagliani qualifying 1.3 seconds off the pole, and half a second off the fastest Honda. The remaining entries took up four of the slowest six times. The Lotus-powered cars were capable of finishing mid-pack, and they did at the four opening road courses of the season, with Sebastian Bourdais picking up the engine's best finish of 9th at Barber Motorsports Park. Despite some fairly decent finishes, the power deficit was noticeable, and with the 96th running of the Indianapolis 500 looming, that deficit became magnified. By the time the month of May rolled around, three of the four full-time Lotus-powered teams had terminated their contracts with the British engine supplier, leaving Simona Di Silvestro and HVM as the only full-time entry. But as the old adage goes, when one door closes, another one opens. That door was for John Alesi and the FanForce United team, who would both be making a debut one-off entry in the Indianapolis 500. Neither Alesi nor Di Silvestro were able to break a 210-mile-per-hour lap average in the first couple days of practice, at a time where their competitors running Chevrolet and Honda Power were setting laps eclipsing 220 miles per hour. And that difference only grew larger when the turbocharger boost was increased for qualifying, which saw the top team setting laps north of 226 miles per hour over a 4-lap average, while Di Silvestro and Alesi struggled to go faster than 214 and 210 miles per hour respectively, securing them the final two spots on the starting lineup. 1 week later, race day. After Jim Nabors sang Back Home Again in Indiana, virtually, and Mary Holman George gave the command to start the engines, the field of 33 took the green flag. It was almost immediately clear that neither Lotus team was able to find more pace before the start of the race, with both cars running more than 20 seconds off the race leaders after only 6 laps. Both Alesi and Di Silvestro were ultimately black flagged and retired after only 10 laps for failing to run within 105% of the pace from the leading cars. For the remainder of the season, HVM Racing was the only team to continue using the Lotus engine. At the end of June, Lotus were allowed to upgrade their engine to try to close the gap to their Chevrolet and Honda-powered competitors, but as is the case many times in situations like these, the damage was already done. DiSilvestro was able to secure a few mid-pack finishes throughout the middle and end of the season, although the team had to go through a handful of engine changes in the process. Lotus announced the termination of their contract to supply IndyCar engines in December of 2012, and Chevrolet and Honda have remained the only manufacturers in IndyCar since. John Alesi retired from racing at the end of 2012 and never got his chance to compete in the Indianapolis 500 again. As for Simona DiSilvestro, well, she just secured a dramatic return to the Indy 500 after a 5-year hiatus by qualifying in the final available spot yesterday for the Penske-affiliated Peretta Autosport. So there you have it, the fate of the short-lived 2012 Lotus IndyCar program. I did abbreviate most of the results from the 2012 season to make this video more concise, but all of the results are available on Wikipedia for those interested. As always, I'd appreciate you leaving a like on this video if you enjoyed it, and feel free to subscribe if you're interested in more IndyCar content like this in the future. For now, I need to start work on next week's video.